So Gabriella is a Macaulay Honor student, honor scholar at John Jay College. She is a senior research assistant in Dr. Darren Strange's memory lab. Gabriella also recently taught a course to high school students on memory errors in the criminal justice system. So now, Gabriella.
Today I'm going to be talking about the associative power of different titles that we law enforcement use in the criminal justice system and how strongly each of these titles is potentially connected to judgments of guilt. So in 1992, Barry Scheck and Peter Neufeld founded the Innocence Project, which some of you may have heard of. And the goal of the Innocence Project is to use DNA evidence to exonerate people who have been wrongfully convicted. And since this organization was founded, 349 people have been exonerated using DNA evidence. And while this is fantastic, there's a bit of a problem with this because what about cases that don't have DNA evidence? So Drizin and Leo suggest that this is the tip of the iceberg. So essentially, the cases that we know about only tell us a small amount about wrongful convictions cases. Of these cases, they have found that 20 to 25% contained false confessions, which actually contributed to the wrongful conviction. And the problem is that confessions, whether they're true or false, are very potent forms of evidence. And they're very convincing because people don't understand why someone would confess to something that they didn't do, knowing that that will get them into trouble. So what exactly is a false confession? Kasson and Reitzman created a taxonomy of confessions, and they came up with three main types that any false confession can be categorized into. And the first one is voluntary confessions. That means that someone goes into a police station and voluntarily tells the police that they committed a crime that they did not do. Then there are coerced internalized confessions and coerced compliant confessions. And confessions that are coerced, there's usually some element of police involvement which causes them to be coerced. So coerced internalized, usually the person believes by the end that they did actually commit the crime. Through different questioning, they come to form basically a false memory of having committed something that they didn't actually do. And coerced compliant is a little different because although they confess eventually, they know that they did not commit the crime. And one infamous case of this is the Central Park Five, where four teenage boys ended up confessing to a crime that they did not commit because the police essentially got them to turn against each other, presented false evidence, and eventually they all said that they, all five of them, committed this crime, and it ended up that they had not. So why is it that people confess? There's a number of different reasons. Innocence is actually a huge reason why someone might falsely confess to a crime. People tend to believe that the criminal justice system works, and having faith in the justice system actually can sometimes be a bad thing because they think that, well, my confession is not true, the things that I'm saying are untrue, and when the evidence comes out, it's going to show that it's not true, and I will be, you know, shown to be innocent. But this doesn't always happen. There are also issues of cognitive impairment or low IQ, even language barriers that mean that people have a hard time understanding what police officers are telling them and can very easily be manipulated. Age is another issue. The length of the interrogation, so being in a room for an extended period of time causes social isolation and you'll be more likely to conform to whatever the police are telling you. And finally, interrogation tactics. So the types of questions that they ask, and particularly the read technique, which I'll get into in a minute. So my main question is it possible that the titles that we use to refer to people, like suspect, criminal, defendant, do these titles have an inherent association with guilty? And does that guilty association then activate a judgment that will trickle down through an interrogation? So the read technique is one of the most commonly used techniques in interrogation. And it was created by Inbau, Reed, Jane, and Buckley. And it starts off with a non-confrontational interview, which is a series of questions that are meant to help interrogators determine whether someone is guilty or innocent. But they use a deception detection technique that they claim is 85% effective, but is actually not as effective as they say it is. And what they end up doing is, by monitoring what the suspect is saying, they determine whether that person is lying or telling the truth, guilty or innocent. And once they have determined that someone is guilty, then they move on to the next phase. So only guilty people will move into the interrogation phase, which is highly confrontational, it's accusatory, they use good cop, bad cop tactics, and overall, this makes the Reid technique very guilt presumptive. Once you get to that last phase of the interrogation, the goal of the interrogation is to elicit a confession. So you have already been deemed guilty, you must now confess. So as I mentioned, the deception detection accuracy is not actually very good. It's very difficult to tell just using verbal and nonverbal cues whether someone is lying or not, because if you have a bias about what that person is saying, if you've already predetermined that that person is guilty, then the things that they say, the behaviors that they exhibit, are going to confirm your beliefs. So law enforcement don't perform better than untrained college students. So this is a problem. And it's even a bigger problem because law enforcement tend to have higher confidence in what they're doing than college students. So we would hope, right? But if their rates are not much better, then we have a tremendous problem. And the rates are actually 54%. So regular deception detection techniques that law enforcement are trained in, they yield effects of 54% accuracy. And this is the same with college students. This is no better than chance. Trying to read how someone is behaving and what they're saying for lying or truth-telling is really not effective in this way. In a study conducted by Meister and Kassin, they found that there's actually an investigator bias effect, which means that investigators tend to believe that people are lying to them more often than not. Whereas lay people actually go to the other end, so they tend to believe that statements are more truthful. So, where exactly does this guilt presumptive nature begin? Why is it that law enforcement are so quick to believe that someone is guilty and lying? So, we wanted to see if these titles that we use exist in a hierarchy. So, logically, the terms at the top or towards the top should have a weaker association with guilty, because those people are not as guilty as, let's say, someone who has been through a trial, there's lots of evidence against them. That should hold a higher association with guilt. So do these exist in a hierarchy? And we are basically saying they do not. They should, we should be able to say that they do, but they don't in fact. So there's an unconscious activation of guilt that we're saying happens, and this is because concepts and terms are stored together. So all of those terms are stored together and through experience and exposure, and so when you activate one of those words, the entire system kind of activates together. And an example of this is using the DRM paradigm. So all of the words on the outside are related to the central word, which is red. And if we show everyone, if we show a group of people the words on the outside one by one, and we ask them to repeat the words to us, about 60% of the time, they will have a false memory for having seen the word bread. So this is the activation monitoring theory, which states that if we activate individual pieces of a semantic network, that we can cause a false memory. So our guilty DRM list was created by one of my mentors in the lab, and we wanted to see if we could manipulate this list a little bit. So usually, the false alarm rate is about 80 to 90% of the time, but what happens if we take the word criminal and we swap out each of these words? And our prediction is that all of those words will have an equal association with guilt, that the rate of the false memory will not change depending on which word we fill in that slot. So if our hypothesis is correct, then that means that there is an unfair system just because of the titles that we use to refer to people, whether it's a suspect or a defendant, those words carry a very heavy judgment of guilt that will trickle down through an interrogation.